This is going to be your guide to breeding in Pokemon Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. If you enjoy the video or if it helps out in any way, don't forget to leave a like and share the video with your friends. So we got what we are looking for, a flame body Pokemon. So let's go and catch ourselves this Magcargo. Since the secret, or at least the straight up information about breeding Pokemon Brilliant Diamond Shining Pearl, is that it's just like every other Pokemon game when it comes to breeding. So you need to get the basics down and then you optimize it. And that means you're going to need a few basics like the Destiny Knot and a Flame Body Pokemon. So an easy way to get a Flame Body Pokemon is to go to the lava biomes in the underground. That is where you can find Slugma and Magcargo once you have the national dex. And then as you just saw, we can get a Destiny Knot on Route 224 once again after getting the national dex. But if you don't want to do all like the Marley shenanigans, you just want to get straight into breeding without worrying about Route 224, pick up Pokemon and have a 1% chance of finding a Destiny Knot, I believe starting at level 11. So if you just have a pickup team for the post game or one or two pickup Pokemon throughout your story playthrough, you might just end up with a Destiny Knot from one of them. Now the reason that you want, no, need a Destiny Knot for breeding is that whenever you breed two Pokemon, the child Pokemon will receive 3 random IV'd stats from the parents. With a Destiny Knot, that becomes 5. Now, 5 perfect IVs, or 5 desired IVs, is generally all that's needed to make a Pokemon quote-unquote competitive. Now, I'm gonna be lazy here, and I'm going to steal from my Generation 7 breeding guide because I've already made the example. So, let's just say you have a Ditto and a random Pokemon. Yeah, we don't have Toxpecs in Diamond and Pearl, or Brilliant Diamond Shine Pearl, because that's Gen 4 decks only, but humor me on this one. So, as we can see, it just randomly takes IVs from the stats of the parent. Now, it can be 5 IVs from one parent, or it can be something like this, where the hit points, special defense, and speed come from the Ditto, or maybe the male Pokemon, and then the female Pokemon will just pass over the defense and special attack, with the attack being completely ignored by both parents, since the Destiny Knot only drops down 5, which means the offspring Pokemon will have those IVs. Now, something important to note about the Destiny Knot is that it is completely random. It's not always going to pull the best IV from a parent. So let's say you have a 6 IV Bidoof, because Bidoof is the god Pokemon of breeding. I did a video on this with the Water 1 and Field Egg group. You can breed Bidoofs until you get like a 6 IV Bidoof, and then you can have that as a father Pokemon to all kinds of other egg groups and stuff. So a 6 IV Bidoof, just because it has 31 IVs in every stat, doesn't mean that the offspring Pokemon will have any 31 IVs in that stat, and also you're just randomly rolling. So it is possible to breed a 6 IV Pokemon, but it's a 1 in 32 chance after you already get the perfect rolls with the Destiny Knot from either parent Pokemon. And because the Poke Radar is so weird in Pokemon Brilliant Diamond Shine Pearl, once again, did a video on the Poke Radar being broken and IVs and stuff like that, you gotta check the description. You gotta go into my playlist to keep up with everything that's going on in Pokemon Brilliant Diamond Shine Pearl. But because it's so weird, power items are back in play. So if you give a parent Pokemon a power item, the stat that item represents will always be inherited. Now, using a power item and a Destiny Knot in breeding will not guarantee a 6 IV Pokemon, since the Destiny Knot is still random, but it can slightly increase your chances. And that's another weird thing, like power items haven't been relevant for breeding since the Destiny Knot came out, effectively, because you want the Everstone, and we can talk about getting the Everstone. Pretty much just dig in the underground. You're gonna spend a ton of time in the underground, get some Everstones, and what happens is the Pokemon, like the parent Pokemon you give an Everstone to, will pass down its nature. So this is gonna be really good for getting a competitive Pokemon, because a nature is very important, and the mints, even though they're in the game, are very expensive. The 50 battle points for a single Pokemon are way more frustrating to get than the Everstone to just have that for all breeding of all Pokemon, and that's also where it goes back into all of the ancestry shenanigans. So when breeding the male Pokemon for an egg group, it doesn't really matter. You can use a power item to kind of enhance that. Let's say you have a male Bidoof that has 3 IVs, like 3 max IV stats, and a female Bidoof that has 2 max IV stats, because chaining is weird and getting IV Pokemon is hard because the chaining, like the Poke Radar, is kind of broken. Well, what you want to do is you want to give the female Pokemon a power item in one of those stats, and then Destiny Knot on the male Pokemon. Nature doesn't matter because we're getting just an IV breeder at that point, and then you keep on going until you have a 6 IV male Bidoof, and then you can give that Pokemon Destiny Knot not. And then female Pokemon, that's going to be the child Pokemon. And that's where it comes down to the female Pokemon of the Pokemon you're trying to breed. Find it in the wild, use Synchronize to get the nature, give that Pokemon the Everstone, and then breed it with the male Pokemon from the egg group. And that should be it. Now, it is worth noting that fossil Pokemon give 3 guaranteed IVs when revived, so you can actually use them for breeding, and you can actually kind of line up the egg groups with it. So Omanyte and Kabuto can be found in the Water 1 egg group as well as Water 3, so if you revive a male Omanyte that has 3 IVs and you breed it with a female Bidoof, can use that to help build out a Bidoof or also expand into other egg groups. So as you can see, there's a lot going on here, and breeding gets complicated, which is why anyone that says breeding doesn't require any skill is an idiot. Also, the Pokemon official rules state that this is a necessary part of competitive, so anyone that says, oh, cheating is okay or hacking is okay because it only matters what happens inside of battle, they're also idiots because, as you can see, there's a lot of work that goes into breeding, and it is a necessary part of the game, so hacking is bad. I don't know why I have to restate this in every breeding guide or constantly in Pokemon, but cheating is wrong, especially in a kid's game. And yet, 90% of the Pokemon community seems to struggle with that. It's sad. And speaking of hacking, if you receive a 5 or 6 IV Ditto in Brilliant Diamond Shining Pearl, it is 100% cheated. Cloning is not allowed, so any clone Pokemon is no different than a hack. You might as well be using Pika Hex at that point. And anyone giving away a 5 or 6 IV Ditto clearly hacked, because the amount of work it takes to get a single one of those Pokemon is nearly unfathomable. So to get a 5 IV Ditto, you only have a 0.07% chance of the chain making it to a 100 chain to get 5 guaranteed flawless IVs. But it's not like, oh, I just do a chain 100 times, or like 1500 times and I get it. No, you can make it to chain 80, and then it breaks, chain 80, and then it breaks, chain 85, breaks, chain 30, breaks, because the odds of chaining in Brilliant Diamond Shining Pearl are lower than they were in the original games, which is why the odds are so low. And even making it to the 100th chain, which takes hundreds of hours on average, is still a 1 in 32 chance that you end up with a 6 IV Ditto. So yeah, that's why we are talking about Bidoof, because it's easy to chain Bidoof or find wild Bidoof that just randomly have some IVs, and then use the Destiny Knot and Power Items to eventually breed until you end up with a 5 or 6 IV Bidoof, preferably 6 IV, that way you can just have 6 IV Father Pokemon for all of the egg groups. Which actually really exposes the irony, because if you hack Pokemon, you're a scumbag. If you cheat in a children's game and then deny it, or try to downplay the effects of the objective advantage from cheating in Pokemon, you're a scumbag. So when you break it down, you have these perfect father figures that are needed for breeding legitimate competitive Pokemon, and then the people that support hacking clearly came from a fatherless household. It is poetic. And that brings us to our last step for breeding, which is Snowpoint City. Now, I know what you're thinking. Wait, the breeder's in Celestion Town. What does Snowpoint City have to do with anything? Well, Diamond Dust. If you have Diamond Dust in your game, it means a special effect is taking place, because you are on a special day, and Junichi Masuda's birthday, January 12th, has increased hatching speed. So if you're planning on doing a significant amount of breeding, like, yo, I'm just gonna make like 10, 15, 20 competitive Pokemon today, or you're just like going on some kind of crazy grind, what you want to do is you want to change your clock to Masuda's birthday. But that's where we can see a problem, because time skipping seems to affect the special days, and that's why I say go to Snowpoint City, because you can actually use Snowpoint City to see if your timer locked out on specific days. That I changed the date, and we don't have Diamond Dust. I even restarted the game, and still no Diamond Dust. So until a time-skipping method like Pokemon Sword and Shield is discovered that bypasses the time lockout, you need to get math with it. You need to kind of plan your breeding at least 24 hours in advance. But if I just go, all right, I'm just going to set the clock back here, that's actually not going to help me at all, because, well, now, after we're done waiting for the 24-hour penalty to expire, we're only going to have 5 hours left, because there's only going to be 5 hours in the day. So that also means, like, well, doesn't that mean I just want to kind of go straight to, 12 a.m. or something? But then you also have to think about real life. Where am I going to be 24 hours from now, and what time will be best for me? So maybe it's like, oh, I have work, or I have school, or maybe I'm just going to plan this for, a day and a half away. So you actually have to, adapt this into your personal schedule to be like, okay, will I be free, or, will I have the most time available when the game clock ticks over to the 12th? More than 24 hours from now. So, you might even do something like this, to where it's like, well, you know, it's gonna be, 26 hours. and then I'm going to have the most free time, and then that means it's going to actually become midnight on the 12th in my game, even though it's like 7 a.m. in my real life, but it means I have like 12 hours all day because it's my day off or something. So if you want to sweat like that for the breeding, you can, and it's going to increase the efficiency. Also, anyone that says, like, oh, no, all you have to do is just, like, set your clock a minute before the time ticks over and you're fine. No, that's not how it works. We can prove that. So we have it on January 11th, 11:59 p.m. We turned off our game before then. We're going to go in. We're going to refresh the area and all that. It doesn't work. Anyone that said that is a fraud because they didn't test anything. They read a false article online and they just like stole someone else's post that was just wrong anyways. There's a 24-hour lockout. I've heard of maybe some union room shenanigans that work like Pokemon Sword and Shield, but it hasn't been fully tested. So yeah, until a major time-skipping method is discovered, you kind of got to sweat it on the breeding, but when you do, it's going to be pretty cool. Or you can breed without it. It's a 10% increase to the speed, so it's very helpful, but at the same time, eh. So January 12th, 12 a.m., we let it tick over, and no diamond dust. It's just snow. You'll know when you have diamond dust. It's actually pretty cool. So again, you can kind of also use this as a method of testing if you're time locked out, depending on the days and the stuff you're trying to find. You can also use it as a method for testing a time skip. That if you like go underground or you play with like the communication features similar to Pokemon Sword and Shield, you go to Snow Point and you have diamond dust on day you're supposed to have it, then that means you actually did it successfully. And please comment down below because everyone needs to know that method. Also, this is a very important thing that needs to be noted in the video because people don't understand how Pokemon works. Hyper training never passes down IVs. So you can't catch a Ditto, train it to level 100, hyper train all of its stats, and then use it for breeding. That is not a 6 IV Ditto. That is not a 6 IV breeding Ditto. So if it shows hyper trained, that means hyper trained. If it shows best, it's hacked. And then the last thing to talk about is that the egg move feature from Pokemon Sword and Shield is in Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. So what this means is that you don't have to breed two Pokemon to get an egg move into a Pokemon. That let's say you already have like a competitive Pokemon or you want to change the moveset, or you just have a Pokemon you want an egg move on. So all you need to do is take a Pokemon that has an egg move you're looking to transfer on the same species. Evolutionary line doesn't count, so Apom and Ambipom are incompatible, but Ambipom and Ambipom are compatible, so what you want to do is you want to delete a move that you don't care about, and then that frees up a spot to where the egg move will then transfer over into the into the recipient Pokemon. But you need to go through an egg cycle for this to happen, and it doesn't matter what gender the Pokemon are. You have two males, you're not looking for an egg, just looking from bouncing one move from one Pokemon to another Pokemon. The move deleter is in Canalave City, and by going into the underground, you can get egg moves this way, so you don't have to do like some kind of fancy breeding chain or something like that. You can go underground, find an egg move, pass it into another Pokemon the same species for breeding if you've already bred it or something, and that is going to be a little bit of quality of life, which is really needed after all the shenanigans that are going down with getting IVs. And after that, you ride. You put a male and a female Pokemon in. The female species is going to be the offspring. People struggle with this because Wolf Glick, former world champion, is a confirmed hacker, and I've seen all kinds of idiotic comments like, well, what if you had a female Rattata with a Dream Ball and a male Pikachu, and then you bred it that way? Well, that means you end up with a Rattata offspring, and you will never get the species of the male Pokemon. So it needs to be said because Pokemon community, as we discussed with the hacking, pretty toxic and scummy, unfortunately. And then to receive your egg, you talk to this old man. When an egg is available, he will turn to the right. You interact with him, you get the egg, you have your flame body Pokemon, and then you just go up and down until it hatches. And that is going to be it. So I hope you guys enjoy the video. Hope you all have a nice day. If I missed anything, it might be in the comments or a future video or something. But I think that's pretty much everything. Again, there's a lot going on here. It's complicated shenanigans, so if you guys enjoy the video, hope you all have a nice day. Thank you very much for watching.